Hi everybody, happy Tuesday. Missed not seeing you guys yesterday via computer screen. But hopefully you guys got through your chapter six checkout, you're done with that. We really didn't need to cover too much in person since you knew a lot of the material. So I'm kind of glad we were able to kind of knock out a chapter of algebra while we are virtual together. So sorry to tell you, but we are starting chapter seven, which is new material, kind of. We have a foundational understanding, but we are going into exponents. Ooh, I was so scared to tell you guys. I feel like our class has like a PTSD with exponents after that one activity that took us like days in class. But we're going to take it really slow. We're going to make sure we really understand every property, and we're in this together. We can do it. Two things. Before we start today, please make sure that you guys have paper and pencil because there will be times that I tell you, okay, you stop, you give this a try. It'll be good for you to kind of practice along with me. Also, we are doing a Team 8-1 Gym Kit live today at 1 o'clock. So I know last week we played as our class. Today we will allow the whole team to play if they want to. It'll be way more fun to have more people in, and then we'll go back to our class doing some games. And you let me know if you want to do a quizzes one day, we can do that. We're gonna do Quizlet again. Scott will play. So yeah. Okay, so make sure grab paper and pencil. If you need to pause the video, you can. You'll need it today. You also might want a calculator and your notebook, obviously. Okay, so your goal for today is that you can simplify exponent expressions. Don't make it any harder than that. All we're doing is we're looking at expressions and we're simplifying them using the strategies that we know. At the end of chapter seven, this is like our end goal. So we want to be able to get to something like this. We can do it. I promise we can do it. We just need to learn the different rules slowly, make sure that we understand them. And by the time we get to the end of chapter seven, we can piece together this expression right here that I screenshotted from your test, and we can get that done together. Promise. So here we go. All right. So take a look at this chart here. This would be a time that you should pause the video, see if you can fill it in without your calculator, and see what you can come up with. So pause quickly and see what you've got. Okay, remember, when we are looking at expressions, if I said 2 to the fourth power, that's really 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, which that would give you 16. Okay, where did my 16 go? There it is. 2 to the third would be 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8, and so on. The really important part that I want you to see from this chart here, and obviously, hopefully, we know this, like 2 to the first power should be 2. 2 to the zero power is 1, and we're going to talk about that property today. When we see negative exponents, okay, when you see 2 to the first power, that's the same thing as saying 1 over 2 to the first power. And then ask yourself, what is 2 to the first power? It's just 2, so that's really just 1 over 2. So these down here, we are going to get into those today, and we're going to look at the kind of fundamentals of having negative exponents and how to rewrite those and simplify them. So this is like our jumping in with our chart, bringing us back to exponents. We are going to focus on the zero exponent strategy today, as well as the negative exponent strategy. This is something you might want to kind of keep jotting these down in your notebook, just so you have a running record. I think we do have them from a while ago, but maybe just to make sure. For every non-zero number a to the zero power is 1. So that's essentially fancy wording. We're saying any number to the zero power is 1. This is the most commonly missed property because everyone always says, oh, it's a zero power, it's got to be zero. No, it's 1. So if I told you you've got 1 million to the zero power, you would just tell me that that is just 1. Or if you've got negative 15 to the zero power, that's 1. Here's why it works. Let's think back to long, long ago, very start of the year. When you have 5 to the 7th over 5 to the 2nd, if we were simplifying this expression, we would keep our base of 5 and we would subtract our exponents. That's like our basic property here. So we'd keep our base of 5 and we'd subtract these. When you do that, you'd have 5 to the 5th power. Now, let's move that up to the algebraic level here. If we have 4 to the 2nd over 4 to the 2nd, okay, we know that 4 squared is 16 and 4 squared is 16. So you'd have 16 over 16, which is just 1. Okay, so just based on common knowledge, we know 16 over 16, when you reduce that, it's just 1. Now, if we're thinking back to just our exponent properties like we did here, when you've got a number with the same base, different exponents, you can keep your base and subtract these. So if I've got 4 and 4, keep my base of 4, subtract my exponents, it'd be 4 to the 2 minus 2 power, 4 to the 0 power, which is the same as 1. So this is why it works. And if you need to pause it to kind of take a look at it, you can. But any number to the 0 power is 1. So that's our first property. Moving on, this is our negative exponent property. You guys, this is going to come in huge handy. If you can learn this and master this, it's going to really help us as we get to the end of chapter and we have to combine a bunch of properties together. So let's think back to our chart that we looked at on the orange slide a little bit ago. When you've got 10 to the second power, that's the same thing as saying 10 times 10, which is just 100. Wow. But what if you had 10 to the negative 2 power? We know 10 squared is 100, so what's 10 to the negative 2 power? When you see this negative exponent, you need to rewrite that. Remember, and hopefully you can remember my hand movements, if it's on the top, so technically right now, 10 to the negative second power, this is, if you wrote it as a fraction, it's written over 1, because it's just like a regular number. If your negative exponent's on the top, we send it to the bottom. Or if it was in the bottom, we send it to the top. So 10 to the negative second power is really, it would really just look like this. We send it to the bottom. Remember that it loses the negative exponent when you do that. And then 1 over 10 squared is just 1 over 100. So take a look at how these are a little bit different. 10 squared is 100. 10 to the negative second power is 1 over 100. If you had, I don't know, 3 squared, that would be 9, but 3 to the negative 2 power would be 1 over 9. 5 squared would be 25. 5 to the negative 2 power would be 1 over 25. So as soon as you start to see that relationship, it's going to really help you out. So if we wanted to generalize, here's what it would look like. And this is when you should grab your spiral and keep yourself a running record. When you see that you have any number, and we're going to use A to generalize, to the negative x power, we would send that to the bottom and it would become positive. So if you had 3 to the negative second power, that's your clue to say, uh-oh, if it's in the numerator, I need to send it below. And it'd be 1 over 3 squared, which is just 1 over 9. And this is taking me forever, so I'm just going to verbalize this one. If you have 5 to the negative 3 power, that's the same thing as saying 1 over 5 to the third, which would be 1 over 125 as a fraction, because 5 to the third is 5 times 5 times 5. Okay, so now here we go. Go ahead and grab your paper and pencil, pause the video, and see if you can simplify this expression. There's only one step to do so, so pause and try. When you're looking at this expression and I'm asking you to simplify it, there is only one thing that you need to do. You see, you've got 5, a to the third, b to the negative second power. So number one, you can't combine anything. There's nothing to combine. But when you see that you've got this negative second power here, that's your clue. We can't have negative exponents. We've got to send it to the bottom, to the denominator. So when you rewrite that, it looks just like this. 5, a to the third, and then your b to the second comes down here and it loses the negative. So notice, this looks kind of complex, but all you really had to do, you guys, was just take this whole guy and just send it down below, which is what we did. All right, moving on. Here's another one. So go ahead, give this a try, pause the video, and then you can see how it's simplified. Right now, if I asked you to simplify this, there's only one step to do. You have 3 over x to the negative 4th power. The thing that should be jumping out at you right now is this negative exponent. When you have a negative 4 exponent in the denominator, you've got to send it to the top for it to become positive, and it would just look like that because there's nothing else combined with your 3, so it's just 3x to the 4th. So I think one of the problems that we had as a class a while ago is that we would make these things so complicated in our head, but it really isn't. A lot of times it just takes one or two steps to simplify. All right, here we go, moving on. These were two others that were in your book. So if we were in person together, I would probably be assigning you guys book problems, and here were two to look at. So pause, give these a try, and then play again, and I'll show you how to do it. When you're looking at c to the negative 5th, d to the negative 7th. First of all, these are combined by multiplication. It's not written in there, but we are supposed to assume that. There's only the only thing you can do to simplify it is to get rid of the negative exponents and send them both to the denominator. When you do that, it looks just like this. Now, because you didn't have a specific numerator after you sent both of them down, we just use one, and then both of these become positive. And remember, we write them in alphabetical order, so C comes before D. Hopefully, you knew that. For this guy over here, this is so important. And I'm going to say it twice so that you really understand. Whenever you have something to the zero power in these expressions, you can just get rid of it because anything to the zero power is one. And when you multiply anything by one, it stays the same. So when you see that you've got d to the zero power, you can go ahead and mentally cross that off. We don't need to worry about it anymore because it's just multiplying it by one, it stays the same. Now you can focus on simplifying what you need to. So I see 6a to the negative first, c to the negative third. The only thing that needs to move down below are both of these because they have negative exponents. My 6 can stay where it's at. It's fine. When you do that, it looks like this. Notice that the a is not written with its exponent of 1 because it's just assumed. Like if I gave you the number 7, hopefully, okay, here we go. If I gave you the number 7, technically right now that has an exponent of 1. It's just assumed though. We don't need to go write that in ourselves. So technically, if I told you 7 to the first power, you can erase that exponent of 1. You don't need it. So we brought down a to the negative first and just made it a, c to the negative third and just made it c to the third. This right here is your expression. All right, moving on. To take our knowledge of exponent expressions one step further, we can now start plugging in values for exponents to simplify expressions. So if I gave you this, you've got 3 s to the third t to the negative second. And it wants you to evaluate when s is 2 and t is negative 3. Here's my quick steps for you when you're asked to do this. First of all, simplify this expression as much as you can. So follow the same steps that we did here. Simplify your variables, then substitute in your values, and you can simplify further. It's going to make your life a lot easier. All right, so right now, take a second, pause the video, see what you can come up with, and see if it matches mine after you go through it. All right, so step one, to simplify this expression, I see 3 s to the third t to the negative second. The only thing that I need to do is bring down this t to the negative second to my denominator. Okay, this is the only thing that needs to move down there. That's it. So when I do that, it's going to look something like this. 3 s to the third power t to the second. Remember, it loses the negative because it came down to the denominator. Step two says to substitute in your values. So instead of my s to the third, it's going to be 2 to the third. And instead of t squared, it's going to be negative 3 squared. So you're just taking out your variables and you're plugging in the values that you're given. So here's what it should look like. Notice that only my s, which is 2, got the exponent of 3. And only my negative 3, which is t, got this exponent of 2. So pause it quickly if you need to take a look and kind of compress in your head. So we simplified first, we plugged in our values, and now you just need to simplify again. So if I'm looking at this, 2 to the third power is the same as 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. So really, my numerator is like 3 times 8. The bottom here, if it's negative 3 squared, that's the same thing as saying negative 3 times negative 3, which negative times a negative is a positive. So here's what I've got. I've got 3 times 8 over 9. Hopefully, we know that 3 times 8 is 24 over 9. Now, truthfully, I can't remember, especially because I'm on camera right now, how your book, like how your online assignment is going to want it. So you could either have it as 24 over 9, or you could reduce it or like set it up as a mixed number, which would be 2 and 6 ninths. Which is hard for me to write now. So like 2 and 6 ninths or 2 and 2/3. So just make sure that you're versatile, whether it's an improper fraction or you change it to a mixed number. Okay, let's try this whole step here again, like when you're given an exponent expression to plug in values. All right, grab your piece of paper. You are told that n is negative 2 and that w is 5. These are two different expressions. Okay, they're two different problems. So see if you can plug it in and simplify to one value for each. Start by simplifying the expression, then plug in, then simplify further. All right, let's talk about this first one first. Sorry to be redundant there. If I have, and this is what I did in my paper to show you that I did the same exact thing as you. So number one, I rewrote my values here. And then I just rewrote the whole expression, n to the negative fourth, w to the zero power. Remember, this is very powerful, you guys. When you have a base with an exponent of zero, you can just get rid of it because that just reduces to one, and anything multiplied by one stays the same. So honestly, I just got rid of my whole w to the zero power because I don't need it. Then all I need to simplify is n to the negative fourth power. So when I simplify that, before I plugged in any values, n to the negative fourth is the same as 1 over n to the fourth. Then you can go plug in your value. So you know that you're taking out your n and you're plugging in a negative 2. And then you can ask yourself, what is negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2? And it comes out to 1 over 16. So that's all it is. So I rewrote my expression, I simplified my variables, plugged in my values, simplified again. Here's the second one. Notice that again, I just rewrote this for myself again and I rewrote my expression. Now, when I see 1 over n w to the negative first power, that negative exponent, that's no good. We cannot have that in the denominator. So it's got to come up here, okay? And it becomes a positive 1, which anything to the first power is just itself. So really, w to the first power is the same as 5 to the first power, which is 5. And then it's just an n, which is negative 2, could be left as 5 over negative 2 or negative 2 and a half, either one. Okay, so a lot of information in one video. If you need to maybe retake a look at the examples, rewrite them for yourself, keep them in your notebook, you tell me. But there are more examples in your book as well. So here's your assignment for the day. Number one, 7-1 lesson quiz online Pearson. There are only 5 questions on there because I want you to focus on accuracy. I don't want you guys to be okay with submitting one and then getting like 20%, 40% on it. You want to focus on accuracy. This is a huge fundamental skill for your class for next year and for the rest of your math classes for high school. Number two, problem solving number four is due by 11:59 Thursday night. Most of you did an excellent job at this last week. Some of you need to remember that these are formal writing responses. So it needs to be complete sentences, paragraph form, transitions, and I am looking at spelling too. So focus on that. You've got two things to work on for the week. Other than that, I'll see you guys tomorrow. Have a wonderful Tuesday. Keep yourselves busy. Bye.